This vintage Cyma watch from the 1960s may not be one of the most complicated timepieces ever featured on this channel, but don't let its apparent simplicity turn you off. This is a really nice watch. The movement is well constructed, has a few nice design touches, and it truly does beg the phrase, they don't make them like this anymore. Now, this watch, housed in a 9-karat gold case with a rolled gold expander watch strap, does have personal family sentimental attachment. It was presented to my stepfather's dad in 1969 by the company that he worked for most of his working life, and since then, it was always found on his wrist until he passed many years later. The watch movement has stopped working, with the main complaint being that it was very difficult to wind, and indeed, the crown's knurling is very worn down, and so it's very difficult for fingers to gain any purchase when attempting to turn it and wind the watch up. Now, despite this lack of knurling, there is also another interesting fault which is causing the crown to be very difficult to turn, and I shall show you this later on in the video. Now, I've managed to wind the mainspring and the movement does reluctantly come to life. However, despite being fully wound, the amplitude or the distance the balance wheel is oscillating is very low at just 110 degrees. Now, we would normally expect a vintage watch such as this one to be within the range of 180 to 220 degrees, depending on its position and, of course, state of wear. The rate of the watch does show a rather large loss of time per day, and there is a significant beat error, but I'm not really concerned with these numbers at this stage. The overall reading simply just confirms that there might be a potential mechanical problem to deal with as we progress with servicing this movement. And my thinking is that it could be, and probably is, linked to the cause of the stiff winding. And so, with the movement out of the case and the initial inspection out of the way, I can now remove the dial and the hands and inspect under the dial. And it all looks good with no evidence of any rust or corrosion, which is all too common with 9-karat gold watch cases of this era, and could have been the cause of the stiff winding, but I'll continue to strip the movement to pieces, starting with the hour wheel and the cannon pinion. And turning the movement over, I can now remove any wind from the mainspring by holding back this click spring and allowing the ratchet wheel to turn in reverse. And now I can safely remove the ratchet wheel. And this exposes a lot of dried oil which has spread away from the barrel arbor bearing. And speaking of the bearing, it doesn't look original to me, most likely fitted in the past to overcome some excessive play. This is quite a common repair, and on the surface of it, well, it looks like it was quite well done. And so now I'm removing the click spring, and I'll remove the intermediate winding wheels. And note that the free lines on the heads of any screw would normally mean that it's reverse threaded. Now, a lot of care must be taken to unscrew these in the correct direction so as to avoid their heads from snapping off. The last winding wheel, or crown wheel here, does not want to be lifted away. Now, rather than attempt to force it and scratch any of the barrel bridge, I'll just wait and I'll push it off from below. I can now remove the barrel bridge. And with the bridge removed, I can comfortably remove the stubborn winding wheel. And now I can remove the balance assembly and the pallet fork. And with that done, I can now remove the train wheel bridge, which is secured with two screws. And now I can carefully remove the train wheels and a further bridge, and then this side of the movement is completely stripped down. Now turning the movement over to the dial side, I can now remove the minute and the setting wheels, which are secured below this cover plate. And as you can see, the old lubrication has dried and it's become very sticky to the point that one of the setting wheels has lifted with the cover plate, and this most definitely will have impeded the watch's performance. But with those components now removed, I can complete the strip down by removing the keyless works components. And now with all the components fully stripped down, I shall clean them thoroughly in the watch cleaning machine and ready for reassembly and lubrication. I start the rebuild process by reinstalling the mainspring back into the mainspring barrel using my trusty mainspring winders. The barrel arbor is lubricated and placed within the mainspring coiled hook. And then the barrel lid is reattached and it just snaps into place. And now I can rebuild the train of wheels and secure them with their bridges. and the barrel can be placed into position, and its bridge is also secured with its two screws. Before moving on, I'll lubricate the train wheel and the barrel bearings. I can now install the crown and intermediate winding wheels. The click spring and the click piece are also reattached to the barrel bridge. And finally, the ratchet wheel is fitted and the barrel bridge is completely reassembled. There is a problem with the barrel bridge, but we shall get to that shortly. But first, I turn the movement over and I rebuild and lubricate the keyless works. I will be replacing the winding crown with a new one once the rebuild is complete, just in case any adjustments to the stem length is required. But for now, I shall just keep the old one attached. The lower bearings are lubricated. And now I can fit the minute and setting wheels and install their cover plate. I clean and lubricate the lower shock setting and reinstall it to the main plate. and turning the movement over once again, I reinstall the pallet fork and its cock. And I can now install the balance assembly. The upper shock setting is lubricated and installed to the balance cock. And with some wind applied to the mainspring, the balance springs to life. Although it is very sluggish. Now, there's definitely something still wrong with this. It's going to require some investigating. Placing the movement on my watch timing machine, I can confirm that the amplitude is still very low at around 150 degrees. Now, if you remember, a healthy amplitude would be expected to be closer to 180 or 200 degrees for this movement quality based on its age. And this can be caused by many things, such as chipped pallet stones, impulse jewel, incorrect balance spring shape to over-lubrication or even under-lubrication, and many other causes. And so the best way to track down is by process of elimination and deep inspection. However, we already do have a clue regarding some work done to this movement previously. The barrel arbor bearing has been replaced during a previous service, and if this was done incorrectly, then we would get the same symptoms that we are witnessing. So that's where I'm going to start investigating. And sure enough, as soon as I loosened the two barrel bridge screws ever so slightly, the balance amplitude immediately improves. Now, removing the balance assembly, ratchet wheel, and the barrel bridge screws, I can see that the barrel bridge rocks due to the bearing here being placed too low and fouling the top of the barrel arbor. Now, when the bridge screws are tightened, it effectively pinches down on the barrel arbor, causing way too much friction. Now, for reference, there should be around 2/100ths of a millimeter gap between the top of the barrel arbor shoulder and the bottom of the bearing. And off camera, adjusting the bearing height using my dueling tool, I've created a suitable gap, and now the barrel bridge does not rock from side to side. And with everything reassembled and the barrel bridge properly secured with its two screws, the balance now seems to have a healthy amplitude. And this is confirmed when I place the movement back onto my watch movement analyzer. The rate does need to be dealt with, but the amplitude is now over 190 degrees, and that makes me happy. I shall do some final timing adjustment later, but for now I'll continue and replace this dodgy crown. And with that done, I tweaked the movement timing until we've got a good reading. And for this age of watch, I could not expect any better than that. Now, it's certainly a huge difference from where we began. And for those of you used to seeing the result on a Chinese time grapher, well, here you go. So with most of the work done, I can now case this movement up. Now start by placing the hour wheel and its washer into position, and I can then refit the dial and hands. And I've cleaned up the case and the bracelet in the ultrasonic machine, but by request of the owner, no polishing, just a light buff. And we're done. Thanks for watching.